Suppose I threw a £50 note out of the window every second of every minute of every day. How long would it take me to chuck the UK national debt out of the window? Would it be a year? Would it be 10 years? Would it be 250 years? Well, to chuck the UK national debt out of the window, it would take me more than 3,000 years. In other words, if I had started doing this in 1000 BC, that's before the Trojan War, I still wouldn't have finished. I hope you're picking all these up.
We're in debt because for years government has been spending vast sums of money it didn't have. But we are told that we can't now shrink the state because that would hurt poor people. Supporters of our supersized state like to depict it as a kind of Robin Hood, stealing from rich folk like Andrew Lloyd Webber to feed the poor. This appeals to our sense of fair play, but how accurate is this notion of the Robin Hood state?
Taxes are a colossal burden on virtually everybody in Britain. Taxes aren't for the super rich or even just for the affluent. They hit everyone.
The government is spending over 50% of national income this year. You can't tax 50% of total national income just by taxing rich people. There aren't enough of them and they don't earn enough money.
If you're working on a fairly lowish wage, let's say £8,000, £9,000, £10,000 a year, you are still being clobbered for taxation. Not just in your, you know, taxes you'll pay on your income, but VAT of 20% on everything you buy. When you actually add it all up, the proportion of your money that you've given to the state is vast.
It is the middle class, it's the bulk of the population, and it is the poorest who pay most tax.
It's only when you sit down and add it all up that you realise what high levels of tax people are paying. Someone earning £12,500 a year, that's about the minimum wage. They're paying almost £7,000 in tax. Over half their income is going straight in tax.
Much of Britain's bloated benefits system involves what accountants call tax churning. One third of households in Britain receive more than half their income in the form of state benefits, which have to be paid for out of taxes which are often levied on the very same households.
If you look at very low income people, again minimum wage earners, they're paying as much in tax as they're getting back in benefits. So you're getting this huge churn where the money's flowing around in a great circle with, of course, a lot of bureaucrats to administer it on the way round. And effectively, they're only getting back in benefits what they're paying in taxes.
The Robin Hood state is simply a myth that's used to justify punitive levels of taxation.
The state accounts for more than half of all spending in the UK. And yet the genuinely helpless and vulnerable still lead miserable lives.
The saddest thing is that they haven't accomplished anything with that tax money. They could have taxed us at a fraction of that level and still alleviated poverty, instead of which they wasted on all sorts of nonsense.
In fact, far from alleviating poverty, the state manages to generate more by paying millions of people who are perfectly capable of working to do nothing their whole lives. Nearly one in five households in Britain is workless.
People want to have some kind of safety net, but Britain has provided one of the worst forms of welfare benefits of any leading country. Other systems around the world are much more demanding. Even in Sweden or Switzerland, you, after a certain time, you're given, for a while, you're given generous benefits, but then the window closes and you are expected to get a job. You are expected, regardless of your qualifications, to take any job. I remember it was a scandal in the 1970s when unemployment first breached 1 million. Now, we would consider that a major achievement. Permanent mass unemployment has become the norm, and it is the welfare state which has facilitated this.
Last year, the government spent more on welfare than it raised in income tax. Benefits must be reduced to a tiny fraction of current levels. It is madness to pay millions of healthy adults to be permanently idle. Together with a few million public sector workers, they must take jobs in the real productive economy. But where will these proper jobs come from? To find out, I'm heading east. The edge of the Pearl River Delta, rising out of the South China Sea, the small hilly island of Hong Kong. This is Asia's Manhattan.
Back in the 1950s, Hong Kong was a funny little hangover from the British Empire. Little more than a shanty fishing port, all junks and rickshaws and pointy hats. Colourful, but desperately poor. Well, it's changed.
The city moves at thrilling speed. It's so clean and prosperous. Everyone is so pleasing and alive and busy. The place reeks with confidence and ambition and dynamism. But it didn't used to be this dynamic. Down below the skyscrapers, a taste of old China. This temple is dedicated to the deity Man Xiong, and it tells us a lot about how China used to be. Because before he died and got promoted to God, Man Xiong was a state bureaucrat. He's still worshipped by civil servants. In ancient China, even heaven was bureaucratic.
There are two great examples in history of civilizations which were unable to develop, which failed to progress. Ancient Egypt and ancient China, both of them run by vast parasitic bureaucracies. In fact, British senior civil servants still refer to themselves as mandarins, after the state bureaucrats who ran China for centuries.
To see how quickly Hong Kong has transformed itself, I've come to see one of its most famous politicians. Andrew Wong was president of the Legislative Council in Hong Kong when it was handed over to China.
Hong Kong's a name that the British invented. Before the British came, on Hong Kong Island there were some villages. But this is Hong Kong Island, that's Kowloon Peninsula.
And this looks like a kind of shanty town, isn't it?
It's a shanty town, 1950s, I think. A shanty town mushroomed throughout the whole of Hong Kong. This is Hong Kong Island, early 60s. Hong Kong started to pick up in the 1960s. I took that ferry boat to school.
The man who is widely credited with transforming Hong Kong was a Scottish civil servant called John Cowperthwaite, who took over as financial secretary here in 1961. Cowperthwaite was an old-fashioned classical liberal. It is said he slept with a copy of Adam Smith's Wealth of Nations by his bed. He believed the best thing government could do was as little as possible.
John Cowperthwaite was a private man, humble, publicity shy. He'd been quite embarrassed at the thought of being cast in bronze. But if there's one person responsible for the economic miracle in Hong Kong, it's him. Why do you have a statue of John Cowperthwaite in your office in Hong Kong?
Because he's my hero. He set the roadmap for us to go and create the last 50 years prosperity in Hong Kong.
Cowperthwaite believed tax was a terrible imposition and an obstacle to growth. So he scrapped lots of taxes and limited income tax to just 15%. Today, still, taxes are low and paid only by the better off. Most people in Hong Kong pay no tax. The effect has been amazing.
By having a lower tax, there's more incentive for the people to make more money and for the economy to become more prosperous.
When you tax people, you're actually punishing success. The higher the tax is, the more punishment you put on success. This is one thing that you don't want to do if you want people to succeed. You don't punish them, you don't tax them. This is the basic lesson we learned here.
So how long does it take them to grow this big?
Jimmy Lai escaped from communist China as a boy and came to Hong Kong with a dollar in his pocket. He's now the billionaire founder and head of one of China's biggest media companies.
It's amazing. You know, you feel all the energy all of a sudden. You know, you feel that, you know, there's nothing to stop you. And that's what John Cowperthwaite has given this praise. The aspiration, the hope, and the energy.
John Cowperthwaite is one of my favorite civil servants, probably, in fact, my favorite civil servant of all time.
Cowperthwaite went out there as a civil servant, and his job was to keep Hong Kong under control, but otherwise not to do anything. And he had the good sense not to do anything.
Once the government used to pressure that government should intervene in this and that and that and that and that, then you have a larger and larger public sector and a smaller and a dwindling private sector. And that's the end of the economy. And that's also the end of a civil society too. And I think that's very bad.
Britain was going down the road of a massive welfare state, very high levels of taxation, a very large interventionist government. But instead, Hong Kong chose a completely different path.
And as a result, Hong Kong flourished.
Growth exploded. The economy is growing by, you know, very large amounts every single year, year after year after year.
And it grew much faster than Britain did and became richer than Britain per capita in, I think, about 1999 or something. It was a big, a big event. Stars shining
bright above. John Cowperthwaite knew that lower tax meant higher profits, that higher profits meant more growth, and that more growth meant more jobs and higher wages. Before Cowperthwaite, Hong Kongers were about a third as rich as the British. Today, GDP per capita here is a third again higher.
The odd thing is, back in 1960, say, the average Hong Konger would have probably given their right arm for the chance to live in Sunderland. Nowadays, I suspect they'd regard it as a prison sentence. Birds singing
in the sycamore tree. A small state and low taxes did for Hong Kong exactly what they had done for Britain in the 18th and 19th centuries. And news soon spread across the region. The Asian economic miracle had begun.